I'd like to introduce now Marcus Miller, who will be introducing tonight's speaker. Marcus is a jazz saxophonist, and I first met him because he loves math, and he came to MoMath and said, we should do something together. And since that time, we've done a lot of things together. Marcus was a math major at Harvard University, and he's now pursuing a very successful career as a jazz musician. But he's also helping us kick off this February 17th, a new monthly series here called Quadrivium. He'll tell you more about it, but if you want to come and experience math, music, and really interesting conversation, I suggest you mark your calendar for February 17th. And with that, I'm delighted to bring up my good friend, Marcus Miller.
Thank you so much, Cindy. So a little bit about the Quadrivium series. I first became aware of MoMath because my little sister took a class trip to the Museum of Mathematics. The family then told me that a Museum of Mathematics existed, and immediately I said, well, next weekend we're going. And I came here and immediately, you know, I said, I want to work with these people. This is an amazing place. And in the past year, we've done a lot of work together, and it's been really exciting as a place to discuss mathematical ideas, kind of bring them to the mainstream and think about them differently, and hopefully to add kind of like a hip chic to technical thinking. Where in New York, we have Silicon Alley. We have a lot of very educated people who think about technical issues, and oftentimes, though, don't get to talk about the intersection between, say, mathematics and music and kind of different creative arts and all kinds of cool people that I have access to through my network as a jazz musician. So I'm hoping to bring kind of everybody together, have some cool conversations with the Quadrivium series. So hopefully you can come to that. That is February 17th. You can register on the MoMath website. It's going to be a great time. What's also going to be a great time is our speaker tonight, Dr. David Kung. I was here for the talk at 4 p.m. and it was really amazing. You're in for some really kind of cool special moments when he talks about some of these mind-bending paradoxes and the possibility of changing your mind. A little bit about Dr. Kung. He got 3 degrees at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, which is known for its excellent math program, doing his PhD work in harmonic analysis. Then he went to the landed a faculty position, where he's now professor at the University of Maryland, St. Mary's. And in addition to being an excellent mathematician, he does a lot of work in music. He played violin and now works with the community orchestra, plays with them and works with students in the music department, as well as work in activism, where he started programs to bring more young women as well as more underrepresented minorities into mathematics. So you're getting kind of a broad spectrum of interests and a great intersection of mathematics with other things in Dr. Kung tonight. Let's see, so without further ado, enjoy the talk on mind-bending paradoxes and the possibility of changing your mind. Dr. Kung.
Thanks very much. Thanks very much. Thanks for coming out. Thanks to the Museum of Mathematics for the invitation. I want to talk to you about changing your mind. I know that it's possible. I know that it's possible because I grew up in Wisconsin, and I've been hanging out here in New York for a few days. And I know that at one point I thought that like 10 degrees above zero wasn't that cold. Apparently my mind's been changed about that. That was pretty cold a few nights ago. So thanks for coming out tonight, and especially I'm glad we beat the snow. So we're gonna have a lot of fun tonight. We're gonna talk about changing your mind. But I do wanna start with sort of a little bit of a hard story, a difficult story. When I think about changing your mind, I always think about this guy named Bob Eberling. And I think about this really bad day that Bob had. See, Bob was an engineer, and he had this horrible day back in 1986. He spent the entire day going from one boss to the next, trying to convince them to change their minds about something. He did that the entire day. He failed the entire day. At the end of the day, he went back to his wife. He turned to her, and he said, "Tomorrow, the space shuttle will blow up." And it did. You see, Bob Eberling was an engineer at Morton Thiokol, and they were in charge of, among other things, the rubber, the material in the O-rings that held the fuel in the space shuttle. And what he knew is that material was brittle when it got down near 34 degrees, which is what launch temperature was going to be. He could not convince any of his bosses to change their minds about that with fatal consequences. Now, most of us, when we have instances like this where we're trying to change our mind or we're trying to change somebody else's mind, the stakes are not nearly so high. And so I want to talk about some of those instances where the stakes are not nearly so high, but I want to see these as places where we can practice changing our mind. And the first step in changing your mind is admitting that you're wrong. And you may think you're good at this, but if you talk to your close friends or spouses, they will set you straight on this. We, as humans, are really bad at admitting that we're wrong. And so today we're going to do something which is really unusual. Most of the time, we celebrate being correct. We're happy when we're right. Today, we are going to celebrate being wrong. And I know you in New York can celebrate like almost nobody else on the planet. So I want to just hear what it sounds like when New Yorkers celebrate. Let's hear. If you're wrong, this is what I want to hear. Let's celebrate. Let's hear it. Come on. Yeah! All right, that sounds great. So every time you're wrong, we're just gonna celebrate being wrong. All right, so there we go. And the goal here is to be better at changing our minds. That's the goal. So I wanna start with this. This is a very mathematical question, and it'll follow up with a demo. Who's blown bubbles? Like little blown bubbles with kids, right? So sometimes when you blow bubbles, two of them come out attached, right? If you have two bubbles that are the same exact size, you can imagine that the interface between them in the center there is just a circle. It's just a flat circle. So that's an easy question. Here's a harder question. What if one of them is bigger than the other? So here the top bubble is smaller than the bigger bubble. And so the question here is, do you think that boundary, do you think it bends into the larger one? Do you think it bends into the smaller one? Or do you think it's just flat? No, so that's the question. And I actually, you know, this is sort of, you know, I can't blow bubbles, but I can do another demo, which is turns out will help us answer this. And so I have two balloons here. So these are identical balloons, and I've connected them with a valve which is currently closed. And so these, you know, I just blew up one with more air than the other. All right. And so with these, the question here is, if I open the valve, what do you think happens? Do you think air flows from the bigger one to the smaller one? Do you think air flows from the smaller one to the bigger one? Or do you think like no air flows despite the fact that the valve is completely open? Does everybody understand the question? Right. So the sheet that was on your seat when you came in has a bunch of these questions. This is question number one. And every time I'm going to ask you to do the same thing, which is I'm going to ask you to answer this without talking it to anybody. For yourself, what do you think the answer is? And I really want you to mark down, circle the answer you think is correct. And I want you to do that because the research is clear. You will remember all of this better if I force you to take a stand. So take a stand, make an answer, and see, and if you're wrong, you'll get to cheer, right? So take a stand, take a minute. If you haven't marked, I'm trying to delay to give you time to mark down an answer. Okay, now turn to your neighbor and convince them that you have the right answer. Go. All right, so the valve is closed right now. I'm going to open the valve. Let's see what happens. Let's hear it. Were you wrong? Excellent. You know, the thing that I really love about this question is that almost every single person walked into this room tonight with the right knowledge in their head to answer this question for the right reason, and yet the vast majority of you didn't. And I love that about this question, right? So here's the knowledge that you had in your heads that you may or may not have used. This is the graph of how hard it is to blow up a balloon as the balloon gets bigger. On the horizontal axis, you have the volume. On the vertical axis, you have the pressure. And we all know that when you grab a balloon, it's really hard initially, and then it gets easier. And if you've worked with kids, you know that there's an age at which the kids cannot produce enough pressure to get over that hump. And what they end up doing, if you get over that hump for them, then you can hand them the small balloon and they can blow it up the rest of the way. And so if we have this curve, if we think about it, this is maybe where I put those two balloons initially on this graph. And if you look closely, it's the larger balloon here which has the lower pressure. And it's the smaller balloon that has the higher pressure. And so it is, as many of you probably thought, an equalization of pressure. But what you may have gotten wrong is it's the smaller one that has the higher pressure. And so what happens, the smaller one has higher pressure, and so it blows air into the larger one. And this is what happens on the graph when those two happen. And so it does actually equalize the pressure, but it equalizes the pressure in a really for most people, highly unexpected way, these two balloons now have the same pressure in them, right? But this demo doesn't end here. If you look up this demo on YouTube, most people, they end it right here. But if you notice, if we were dealing with soap bubbles, this would be the end of it, because the curve just sort of goes down, and then the soap bubble bursts. But you notice that toward the right on this graph, the graph comes up again. And what that means is that's properties of the rubber going on. That means that we can do something different. So yeah, first of all, this answers the bubble question. It means that the smaller bubble is blowing harder into the smaller bubble has higher pressure. And so the interface goes down and bends into the bottom one. Were you wrong? Let's hear it. All right. Excellent job. You are being wrong very well tonight. Because that curve goes up, you can actually set this experiment up to do any of the three answers that I had on the board, right? And so I want you to think through, if I had put these two balloons in either one of these situations, if I had put those two balloons as the two dots on either one of these curves, what would happen if I had done each one of those? Go ahead and turn to your neighbor and explain. And I'm going to set this up. And the cool thing about this is I'm going to set this up, and I'm not sure where it's going to be on these curves, and then we'll see. So go ahead and tell your neighbor what's going to happen in each one of those cases. Go. I worry that I'm going to faint sometime when in front of a crowd doing this. All right, I think I have these. So here's the answer to this. If I set this up and it's on the left, what happens? The larger one has higher pressure, and so it blows into the smaller one, and they meet in the middle. On the right, what happens is they have the same pressure already, and so nothing happens. And here's the deal. I think everybody agrees that the balloon on your right is bigger. Is that true? Yeah, but I don't know where these two balloons are on this curve. This is completely unknown to me. So when I open the valve, I don't know exactly what's going to happen. But we're about to find out. So here it is with the valve open. So I felt just a little air move, but essentially they're different sizes, but they apparently have the same pressure. And so we're in this case on the right. We have two balloons that have this different sizes, but the same pressure, like that. All right. So there's balloons and pressure, and I hope you're excited about being wrong, because I think a number of you, are you excited about being wrong? Were you wrong? Let's hear. All right. Excellent work. A lot of the paradoxes in mathematics, the beautiful paradoxes that the math world has, boil down on some level to the liar's paradox. And the liar's paradox is this amazing thing. It's simply, this sentence is false. And when you first come upon this, it's just an amazing, when you teach kids and the first time they read this, it's lovely to watch them sort of chase their tails around and around. If it's true, then it's false, and if it's false, then it's true, and back and forth, and there's no resolution to this. And it's what Douglas Hofstadter calls a strange loop. And strange loops come in lots of flavors and lots of, and we'll actually hear one in a minute, but these strange loops happen in life too. I had my daughter and we were hiking in Hong Kong. We were hiking along, and she was in a really bad mood. I had her in my backpack, hiking along with this guy, talking to him. And I was talking to him in Chinese. And so we were talking, and she was just sort of ignoring us. And at some point, he looks at me, and he motions to her and says, "Ta ting de dong putonghua ma? Does she understand Chinese?" And she, I didn't say anything. I look up at her, and she turns to him and says, "No." That's a strange loop, right? Somehow it's self-contradictory. Escher did wonderful art around strange loops. Here are the drawing hands. One hand draws the other, which is flat, which turns into a three-dimensional thing to draw the first. Waterfall is a great example, where the water appears to continuously be going down and then fall down the waterfall and then continue to float downward, right? And here we are, a similar thing. The soldiers here, in ascending and descending, in one direction, they're always walking up. In the other direction, they're always walking down. And it turns out you can do a similar thing with sound. everybody agree that that sound keeps going up in pitch? Everybody also agree that it comes back to where it started? Yeah, strange loops. Strange loops, you can do them with sound as well. Yeah, this New York water is actually, it's really great. You have great water in this city. Woo! It's fantastic. Are we cheering great water too? All right. To being wrong.
You got the best in the country.
Best in the country, yeah. So here I have a tube. I play the violin. I didn't bring my violin, but I have this tube. And when you wing it, when you spin it around, it makes a sound, right? And so I have a question about this sound. So if I swing this tube faster, what's going to happen? Do you think it's going to just get steadily louder like that? Do you think it's going to steadily get higher and higher like that? Do you think it'll do both? Or do you think something else happens? So those are the four options. I want you to, before talking to anybody, circle one of those options, pick one for yourself. What's gonna happen? And then I want to turn you to turn to your neighbor. And I also want to make sure, please make sure nobody is left out in these discussions. Make sure everybody has somebody to talk to. What's gonna happen? Convince them that you're right. Go, talk. All right, here we go. Here we are. Here's the pool tube. I love being in New York, where I mean, you all like prize really nice instruments. Like, you know, a Strat at Christie's is going for $10 million or something. Like I paid $4 for this at the pool store. So here we go. So it definitely gets louder and it gets higher. But did you notice it didn't just sort of get steadily higher? It jumps. Did you notice this? It jumps up, and so, like, in some sense, the right answer is D. Let's hear it. Were you wrong? Woo! Yes! We're doing a great job of being wrong. The mathematics behind a tube of air like this, I love thinking about the mathematics of this, in part because it ties together two of my loves, mathematics and music, but also the math of a tube of air like this is identical to the math of a vibrating string. And in both cases, they tell you that you get only certain harmonics, certain frequencies that can be vibrated on this. And a string, you change the frequency of a string by putting your finger on it, making the string shorter. And a lot of wind instruments you make longer and shorter with things like valves or like a trombone, you can really see it being longer or shorter. But there is a brass instrument that is just a fixed length of pipe like this. You don't change the length of, right? It's a trumpet without the valves. What is it? A bugle, right? Or cornet, a bugle. And what do you hear played on a bugle? Taps. And so the mathematics says that if you can play taps on a bugle, you should be able to play taps on this, because the mathematics is the same. Thank you very much. Yeah. The other wonderful thing about this demonstration is, you remember in your high school chemistry class, maybe you were like me, so like you go through these p orbitals and s orbitals and they tell you that these electrons can only have certain energy levels. And then like I remember asking my chemistry teacher why, and he just said, because, which is a horrible answer, right? But the answer is that because the mathematics says that that's only the only things that are possible, and in fact, it's the same mathematics. The same exact mathematics that tells you that a violin string and a tube of air have this set of frequencies tells you that an electron has only a certain set of frequencies. It tells you there's a reason for these p orbitals and s orbitals, and we use that all the time. We were just there at the Hayden Planetarium. Like, we use that fact all the time because it tells us things about the universe. It tells us about red and blue shifts of light coming to us. Right? We need that all the time, and it's the same mathematics. Poincaré said it best. He said, mathematics is the art of giving the same name to different things. It's the same mathematics, in this case, partial differential equations, that allows us to see that there are these different energy levels and these different frequencies. And that's just a wonderful thing. So I want to ask you a question about adding. Everybody, who's added? Who can add? Right, great, all right. I'm glad we're all on the same page about that. So if you add positive numbers forever, you just keep adding positive numbers, here's the question. That sum, when you keep adding them, do you think that will keep getting bigger and go to infinity? Do you think it'll stop at a finite number, or do you think sometimes it'll do both, right? And so we're going to answer this question. It's not on your sheet. You don't have to take a stand on this right now. But I want to give you sort of a visual of this. Like, here's a box, and we can just say this box is size 1, right? And we can split this box in half, and then it's a half and what's left. And then we can split what's left in half, and that's a half, so now it's a quarter on that bottom part. And then we can split what's left in half again, and that's an eighth, and then a 16th, and then a 32nd, and a 64th, on and on and on, right? But it's still all inside the box. The box has size 1. And what that's telling us is that we must have 1 half plus a 4th plus an 8th plus a 16th plus a 32nd. If you go forever, you just get the whole box, right? And so mathematicians call this a geometric series. And so clearly, at least sometimes, when we add up positive numbers, we end up just getting a finite number like 1. All right. So did you know you can do a musical version of this as well? In fact, like, the language we use to describe the music is mathematics. That's a half note, followed by a quarter note, followed by an eighth note, and then a 16th, and a 32nd, and a 64th. I think my musical program would only allow me to go to a 128th note. But you could keep going forever. And the amazing thing is, in theory, you would put an infinite number of notes inside of a single measure of music. And how long would that measure take to play? Exactly as long as every other measure in that piece of music, with an infinite number of notes. And so that gives us one answer. You don't always go to infinity. But we know sometimes you do. In fact, this is the most famous series that does this when you learn this in calculus. It's called the harmonic series. When I hear that there are calculus students who have learned about the harmonic series, but their teacher has not tied to them that fact, together with the fact that that series of numbers is the same sequence of numbers that came out of that swinging tube, that's where the name harmonics comes from, right? That a little bit of me dies every time I hear that there are students who haven't heard that, right? So it's harmonic series because it comes from harmonics. And the thing we know about the harmonic series is that when you add it up, you get infinity. That series does what mathematicians call diverge. So some series converge to a finite number, some series go to infinity, so clearly we have some of both, right? So here's what I want you to do that is somewhat related. I want you to flip your paper over and just pick a number between 0 and 1. Any number between 0 and 1, not 0, not 1. Any number in between, write it down. Go ahead. Take a second to write it down. All right. Everybody got a number? Great. Just share your number with your partner and people around you. Tell them what your number is. All right. And here's the question I have about your number. Is it rational? In other words, can you write it as a fraction? Remember that if you wrote down like 0.25, 0.25 is a rational number. It's not written as a fraction, but you can write it as a fraction. So is your number rational? Can you write it as a fraction? Right. So raise your hand if the number you picked can be written as a fraction. It's a rational number. Great. And raise your hand if your number cannot be written as a fraction. Great. What do we have? What number?
Pi minus 3.
Anything else?
0.6.
0.6. 0.6 is 6 over 10. No, sorry. Yeah?
Root 2 over 2.
Any others?
1 over pi,
right? We get a lot of pi, a lot of root 2s, right? But it was something like 90% of you picked rational numbers, right? Yeah, so here's an amazing mathematical fact. Fractions are these common things. You could ask yourself sort of mathematically, what are the chances that if we randomly pick a number between 0 and 1, like, and I think about this as like, you know, you have like a really fine razor blade passing over 0 to 1, and it is equally likely to stop at any point on the number line. And if you randomly stop that and get a particular number, what are the chances that it's a rational number? The answer mathematically is 0, which seems strange since around here it was more like 90%. Because the last time I checked, 90% and 0 were different. Pretty different, right? And so I want to prove this to you. So we're going to prove that the probability of getting a rational number is actually 0. So what I want you to, I think we can all agree on this. Like, the chances of picking a number between 1 half and 1, that's like half of the interval, right? And so the chances of picking one of those numbers should be 1 half. Everybody good with that? right? And if we shorten that interval to like between 1/2 and 3/4, that's a quarter of the interval. And so the probability of picking a number in between those two numbers is going to be 1/4. And in general, like the probability of picking x in some interval is going to be the length of that interval. Everybody okay with that? That seems like that by itself seems fine. We haven't done anything mind-bending or crazy yet. So here's what I want you to think about. I want you to pick a c, a positive number c that's really pretty small. Think of c as just being a really small number, and we'll get back to exactly what c might be later. C is some small number. And what I want you to think about is, see that 1/2 in the middle? I want you to put a little interval around 1/2. And the length of that interval I want to be c over 2, 1/2 of c. And what I want to impress upon you is, now, what's the probability of picking a number in that little interval? It's the length of the interval, right? Which is c over 2, right? And in fact, the probability of picking exactly 1/2 has to be less than that, because 1/2 is inside that interval, right? OK, so there's our interval of length c over 2. And now I want to take an even smaller interval, half again is small, c over 4, and put that one around the fraction 1/3. And so now the probability of picking a number inside of that one is going to be its length, which is c over 4. The probability of picking a number that's in one of those two intervals is going to be the sum of those two lengths, c over 2 and c over 4. And not only that, but the probability of picking like either 1/2 or 1/3 has to be less than the sum of those lengths, because those two numbers are in those two intervals, right? And so let's keep going with this. So now I want to cover 2/3. I want to cover 2/3 with an interval of length c over 8, half again as big. And now I want to cover 1/4 with something half again as big. I think I'm at c over 16. And then I think I've already done 2/4 because I have that covered at 1/2. So let's skip to 3/4 and put something of, I think we're at c over 32. And we're just going to keep going. Those are the fourths. And next I'm going to do the fifths, 1/5, 2/5, 3/5, 4/5. And then I'm going to do the sixths and the sevenths. I'm going to think about keeping going. I'm just going to enclose these in ever decreasing sizes of intervals. And here's the deal. Once I've done this, if I've done this forever, I've covered all of the fractions. I did all the fractions with a denominator of 5, and then 6, and then 7, and then 8. I covered all of the fractions, right? And so now the probability of picking any fraction has to be less than the probability of picking any of the numbers in those intervals. And that was the sum of those intervals. And the sum of those intervals, we started at c over 2. And so that's c over 2 plus c over 4 plus c over 8 plus c over 16. We can factor the c out. We get 1/2 plus 1/4 plus 1/8, which is exactly the sum we saw in that box, half of it, and then a quarter, and then an eighth, right? And that summed to 1. And so we get a sum that's just c. So if you read through this inequality, it's saying that the probability of picking a fraction has to be less than or equal to the constant c. And now here's the rub. We can pick c as small as we'd like. We can pick c to be 0.1, 0.01, 0.00001. And therefore, the probability of picking a rational number, no matter what we pick c to be, the probability of picking a rational number has to be less than it. The only possibility is that the probability of picking a rational number is 0. And that's despite the fact that 90% of you picked rational numbers. Here's the crazy thing. Most numbers we can name are rational. But most numbers, in some sense, are irrational. There's a difference between something being just familiar, you know it, and something being actually common out there. And that's a really radical difference. And this showcases it more than anything else. What's really going on here is that the infinity that is the irrational numbers is a bigger infinity than the infinity that is the rational numbers. And so one infinity overwhelms the other, and you actually get a probability of 0. All right, that was a little wacky. I want to return to something. I want to go to something a little bit more down to earth. So here I have a bunch of books, and we're going to stack these books. And so the question is, if I stack these books, how far out can I get the top one? This is a little hard for you to see. I'm gonna hold this up. So I'm gonna stack on the edge of the edge of the table is going to be right here, and I'm going to stack these books out over. And the question is about this top book, and the question is, how far out over the edge can this top book go? And so I have some options here. Maybe you cannot get this top book to be over the edge of the table. It just can't get that far. Maybe you can get it to just be barely off the edge of the table. Maybe you can get it well over the edge. Or maybe you can stack these all the way to New Jersey. Right? That's the question. You have it on your sheet. So take a stand, circle an answer. Go ahead and circle an answer. How far out can you stack the top book? Go. All right. I'm going to start stacking up here. We have some people who are right in line with this. I'm going to leave it up to you to sort of judge whether or not we're out over the edge. I think what everybody can believe without too much is that this top book can only go out like halfway over the previous one. Everybody got that? Right? And so, you know, if I stack these, I can't, if this were the edge of the table, I can't get more than half. It would just fall off the edge, right? And so that top one can only go halfway out. In fact, half is sort of like the edge of that. If I take it a little too far, it won't be able to go. So there's one half. If you do it with two books, and so I'm going to do it here with just taking the top two books. If you do that and you sort of do it carefully and you can do the calculation, what you find is that second book can extend a quarter past the edge of the table. So now I have one half of a book and then a quarter of a book. So that's not out over the edge yet. If I do three, I can get the third one to be 1/6 of a book. And again, this is sort of just on the edge of being of what's possible. And so there, that's stable. But I think you would all agree I'm not out over the edge yet. I'm not out over the edge. And so I'm going to keep going. And here's the thing. If you keep going, what you find out is that you get a particular sequence of numbers. And when you factor out one half, what you end up with is the harmonic series. And what do we know about the harmonic series? The harmonic series diverges. Do you all agree that the top book is actually past the edge of the table? Yeah? That top book is definitely past the edge of the table. With these six books, I've managed to get that top book out over the edge. And what does this tell you? This tells you that the harmonic series diverges, and so it goes to infinity. So that tells you that, like, at least in theory, if I had enough of these books, the correct answer to this question is that I should be able to stack them to New Jersey. I'm going east. I'm sorry. I should be able to stack these as far out the parking lot that is the Long Island Expressway, as far out as I want. I should be able to stack these, right? So in theory, I should be able to stack these books as far as we want, which is sort of an amazing fact. It turns out that if you want to get far, it's pretty difficult. I did a quick calculation. 7 miles might get me to what, like Flushing or something? If you want to go 7 miles, if you want the top book to be 7 miles out past the end of this, you need roughly speaking, you need about 10 to the 8,000 books. One followed by 8,000 zeros. That's the number of books you need. Just as a rough gauge of how big that is, if you look at the number of particles in the known universe, it's about 10 to the 70th or so. 10 to the 8,000 is a little bit bigger than that. All right, let me hear it. Did you get this wrong? Excellent. Excellent work. All right, I have another demo for you, and this involves a slinky, and I need a hand with this. And Greta has agreed to help me out. Could you give Greta a round of applause for helping me with this? So I'm going up here on this ladder, and so I'm going to dangle this slinky. And the bottom of the slinky, I'm going to dangle it, and so we're just going to try to get it so that the bottom, you know what, that's the bad end of this slinky. You didn't know that slinkies had a good end and a bad end, but this one's been around, so we're going to dangle this. I'll give you a little bit more slack. Let's see. Let go, see if it bounces. Oh, that's. I need you a little bit more. All right. Can you oh, there we go. That's the problem. All right. Let's leave it there, Greta. I think that's going to do. So the question is, Greta's going to stabilize the bottom of that until it stops bouncing, and then I'm going to drop the top. And the question is about the bottom of the slinky. Maybe a little lower. Let's see. Keep going until it stops. Are you pulling it? Don't pull it. Just let go. Let it go, Greta. Okay, we're gonna let it. Just put your hand under it, and don't hang on to it. And just keep coming up until it stops bouncing. And don't hang on to it. And now slowly let your hands down. There we go. Just leave your hands right there. And now just take away your hands. There we go. All right, so the question is, when I let this go, when I let the slinky go, what happens to the bottom? Does the bottom of the slinky, does it go up? In other words, does the power of the slinky pull up harder than gravity? Does it go down? Does gravity beat the slinky? Or does it not move? Somehow the bottom, somehow gravity and the slinky, wait. That's okay, right? So that's the question. So circle your answer on your sheet. Circle your answer. Does the bottom of the slinky come up, go down? And I'm asking just initially, right? Because eventually the whole thing's going to fall. I let go. Does the bottom of the slinky move up first before falling? Does the bottom of the slinky fall? Right? All right, everybody have their answer? So here we go. I'm going to drop it on the count of three. One, two, three. What you notice, if you look closely, is it doesn't move. And most people, I'm going to do this one more time. I'll do this one more time. I'll try to get this nice and high so you can see it. I'll give you a little bit more. We have an unruly slinky here. All right, there you go. On the count of three, watch carefully. The bottom of the slinky doesn't move until the top hits it. One, two, three. Do you see that all right? Were you wrong? What I love about this demonstration is the best way to understand this demonstration is not about the slinky at all. The best way to understand this is about information transfer. You see, here's what's going on. You can imagine yourself being like one ring of this slinky, and if you're in the middle of this slinky and I'm holding on to the top, all you know is that there's something pulling you up, and there's an equal and opposite force, which is the weight of the slinky below you pulling you down, and those are equal and opposite, and so you're going nowhere. And here's the thing, like when I let go, the slinky above it doesn't move. The only thing that changes for any of those rings of the slinky is the very top ring of the slinky. When I let go, the force pushing that up is gone. And so that top ring of the slinky compresses. And only then does the next ring of the slinky know, oh, something happened. And so it compresses. And only then does the third ring of the slinky know something happened. So what's really going on, the bottom of the slinky, in some sense, does not know that I dropped the slinky until the information gets there. How does the information get there? By the whole slinky compressing. And only then does the bottom of the slinky go, oh, I got dropped. Right. And down goes the slinky, right? It's about, we don't think about information taking much time anymore. We think about information being instantaneous. But you know, the folks down on Wall Street, they know how important that it is to get the information transfer time right. And that's why they build huge, you know, huge systems to be closer to Wall Street, to make the time between trades even smaller so that they can make more money on that, right? So the information transfer, this is a great demonstration of information transfer and how long it takes. I want to go back to fractions. We had so much fun with fractions. And so I want to think about, imagine you go to the doctor. You go to the doctor and, among other things, your doctor says, drink more water. Because water is great, right? But maybe your doctor says, I'm sorry you have some condition, like kidney stones or something. And like there's two treatments you might have, treatment A or treatment B. And so you have this conversation with your doctor, and your doctor might say, overall, treatment A has better outcomes. And you might say, okay, let's go with treatment A. But your doctor might say, just to be safe, or maybe just to make an extra charge on your file, we'll do an image of your kidney stones, right? So we'll do an MRI. And it comes back, and the MRI says, good news, you have small kidney stones. And it turns out, for small kidney stones, treatment B is better. And you might say to your doctor, oh, well, if I'd had large kidney stones, then we would have gone with treatment A, right? And your doctor might actually say, no. For large kidney stones, treatment B is also better. And in fact, it might be the case that if you put these into like five different bins, kidney stones between 0 and 3 millimeters, 3 millimeters and 4 millimeters, in each one of those bins, treatment B might be better, even though overall treatment A is better, which seems to make no sense at all. Everybody agree with me on that? Yeah. It seems to make no sense at all. So what's going on? So I'm going to give you a different, it turns out, completely equivalent setting, and you're going to just agree with me because the numbers are here. So like when we have basketball fans in here, like when you're talking about basketball players shooting, like you talk about one outshooting the other, it's in terms of the percentage, right? Yeah. And so maybe in the first half, Steph Curry outshoots LeBron James, and in the second half, Curry outshoots LeBron James again in percentage terms. it might be possible that overall LeBron might outshoot Curry. And we can just throw some numbers up here. So in the first half, Steph Curry goes 1-for-7. He's pretty cold, but not as cold as LeBron James, who goes 0-for-3. Does everybody agree that 1/7, whatever that works out to be percentage-wise, is higher than 0?
Yeah.
Good. In the second half, Steph Curry goes 3-for-3, hits 100%. LeBron misses a couple shots, but he goes 5-for-7. Everybody agree that 100% is better than whatever 5-for-7 is? All right, let's add those up for the game. Steph Curry was 4-for-10. LeBron James was 5-for-10. Steph Curry outshot LeBron James in percentage terms in both halves, and LeBron still outshot him for the game. It's just the numbers, right? That's just what the numbers say. It is clearly possible. And now all we have to do is we have to switch, you know, switch out Steph Curry and LeBron James for treatment A and B, and small and large kidney stones. And you have exactly the case that I was telling you. It might be the case that, you know, treatment A is better than treatment B in each one of those bins, the small and large kidney stones, but overall treatment B is better. What's going on here is that we're thinking of these things as fractions. We see them as fractions, we think of them as fractions. And so we think about the relationship that holds for fractions. These are not fractions in that sense, these are ratios. When you added across to get Steph Curry's overall shooting, you added the numerators and the denominators. You treated them as ratios, not fractions. The inequality that we want to be true, right? It does hold true for fractions, but it does not hold true for ratios, and that's why we get this so badly wrong. Our intuition is horrible about this. And this actually happens, right? So there are cases. So here are some examples of this is what's called Simpson's paradox. Berkeley graduate students in the 70s, the Berkeley Graduate School figured out that admissions for women were 10 percentage points lower than for men. And they went around looking for the culprit. Which department is guilty of discriminating against female applicants? And the answer? No department. There was no department where the admissions rate for women was significantly lower than it was for men, but overall it was. Right? And it's just an example of Simpson's paradox. If you look at test scores in this country, you know, when another test score, another international benchmark comes out, you see these graphs in the paper, right? And what you see is overall US test scores are flat or maybe slowly declining, right? Oh, and everybody says, oh, our schools, our students, blah, blah, blah. If they were to split out those scores by race, what you would see is that among white students, scores are slowly rising. Among African American students, scores are slowly rising. Among Hispanic, Latino, Latinx students, scores are slowly rising. In each one of the subgroups, we are getting better. Overall, we're not. And that partly has to do with the fact that we have such a gap between white and Asian students and African American Latino students in this country that as we change the composition of the population, that's what's getting us to have flat scores overall or slightly declining scores. But it's this quirk of statistics. It's Simpson's paradox that allows us this to happen in the subscores. Amazingly, this same paradox helps explain part of the phenomenon of white flight. So white flight was typically, especially in the 60s and 70s, an inner ring suburb that was mostly historically white, and that was historically, by law, it was white. And then slowly a few African American families would move into that neighborhood, and then some of the white families would start to leave, and slowly over time, that neighborhood would turn over from mostly white to mostly black and brown over the course of a few years. And part of what's going on is actually this mathematical quirk. You see, this is what happens. The African American families moving into the inner ring suburbs were the ones who had enough money to move up in the world, and they were moving to an inner ring suburb. But they were coming from places with badly underfunded schools, with teachers with much less preparation. And what was happening is they were bringing their students, those first students were coming into those schools. They had, with their much worse preparation, they would drop the average test score in that school a little bit. And at that moment, the education that kids were getting in that school hadn't changed a bit. It might have even been getting better over time, but the average test score went down. And that is enough to propel some of those white families to say, oh, test scores are going down a little bit. We better move out to a further suburb. And then more African American, more Latino families come in from inner cities, and the test scores go down a little bit more. And it's a feedback loop that just continues to get more poorly prepared students into that school, dropping the test scores more. And at that point, it's possible that the education given to the students in that school is just rising up and up and up, even though the average is going down. It's just an example of Simpson's paradox. Of course, in this case, it's probably an example of, like, you know, racism. But but Simpson's paradox definitely plays a role in this. And this sort of goes to something I think we need to face as a mathematics community. We need to understand that this myth that math is some sort of meritocracy where the brightest sort of rise to the top, it's not only wrong, but it's really damaging. Why is it not a meritocracy? Because there are different opportunities, the different opportunities in terms of funding, in terms of the preparation of teachers, and there's just the historical exclusion of African Americans, especially in education, in higher education, in a lot of our schools. Poverty plays an incredibly important role. And here's how bad poverty is in this country. I actually want you to write down a number here. The median wealth of a white family in this country, I will tell you this one, is $111,000. If you take the total value of everything a white family owns in this country, it is, on the median, is $111,000. I want you to write down what you think the median wealth is for an African-American family in this country. Everybody understand this is not income, this is wealth, the total value of everything you own, including your property, everything else. White family, $111,000. Write down what you think an African-American family is. Go ahead, write it down. The answer, the most recent figures I can find are somewhere a couple of years ago. The answer is somewhere around $12,000. $111,000, $12,000. Poverty affects us differentially, especially differentially by race. If you're wondering about Latinx families, it is slightly higher, like $13,000 or $14,000. Poverty plays a huge role. In addition, there are much more subtle things in effect here, including teachers' unconscious biases about their students. This is especially true of girls in mathematics, where teachers simply do not sort of see those students as bright in mathematics, and those teachers' expectations impact student performance. And in fact, students' own unconscious biases about themselves and the groups they're from. There's a lot of great research out there about stereotype threat. Students' own biases have an impact. All of these are suggesting that mathematics is not a meritocracy. It is not just about the best rising to the top. And we need to change our thinking about that. When we act like it's about a math gene or it's about the best and the brightest, like we are doing damage, and that's something we need to admit we're wrong about. Can we get on board about that? We're wrong about that. All right, I've got another demo here, and I need some help with this one. Let me set this up, move some things aside. Somebody wanna help me out here? You wanna help me out? What's your name?
Joel.
Joel. So Joel's gonna help me out here. So Joel, this is what I have. So I want you to do this. Come on over here. We're gonna make you face so the cameras can see you. So what I want you to do is I want you to pick up these three blocks, just lift them a little bit, and then I want you to pick up just the top one, and then I'm gonna ask you to tell them what you feel. Okay? All right.
Okay, that's relatively light.
Okay.
And now just the top one. That's definitely feels quite a bit heavier than the entire pile.
I want to be clear about this, because when you were lifting the bottom three, correct me if I'm wrong, you were also lifting the top one. Is that true?
Yes.
Okay. But then when you lifted, okay.
Yeah.
Help me again. That's light.
This felt felt lighter than lifting a single one.
And so. So the single one is heavier than it plus two more.
Oh, very definitely.
I'm sorry, I should have been more specific. Can I get a good volunteer up here? I'm just kidding. Hey, do you want to come up and try this? Let's see. Let's make sure. Let's confirm that he is not in fact crazy. Come around here. So again, just all three, and then the top one, and then tell them what you're feeling. Okay.
I don't know if I can do it with one hand.
I think you got it. There's one hand.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it doesn't feel very heavy.
Okay, and now just the top one?
Yes, it also feels heavier.
It's heavier.
It feels heavier than the entire.
Than all three of them.
So I'm guessing there's a magnet or some kind of other thing going on here.
Are you wondering what's under it?
Yeah.
Oh, let's see. Okay, so let's take these to the side. What's under this? Okay. Why don't you pick that up? Like, open.
It feels empty. Looks empty. Okay, empty. But it doesn't tell me about the materials.
All right, but you're still claiming that. Hang on. Let's. So you're still claiming
because
that.
I'm guessing.
That this is actually lighter than just the top one.
That's what it feels like.
Okay.
I agree with all right. that fellow that
all right.
it does that feel. All right.
Thank you very much. Can you give them both a round of applause? There's this thing that teachers do that teachers need to stop doing. And if teachers paid attention to the entertainment industry, especially network television, teachers would get this right. So this is what teachers do all the time. And I'm guilty of this too. So we get through, like, we have a point to make for the day, right? And we get near the end of the hour and we look at our watches and we're like, only 10 minutes. And then we speed up, we go faster, and we get to the conclusion before the end of the hour, and then we're done and class is dismissed and they go away. Right? Who's had that class, right? And the closer you get to the bell, the faster the professor, the teacher goes, and you can't really follow them anyway, right? If network television worked this way, this is what the end of the season would look like. There would be like a cataclysmic event, like a plane crash, and you would know that, like, oh, and then they would speed things up. Oh, there are five main characters on the plane crash, and oh my gosh, it's a plane crash. Some people are going to die. And then if network television worked like teachers, they would tell you right before the end, oh, these three lived, these two died, see you in the fall. This is not at all what Hollywood does. This is, you see, what Hollywood does is they like leave you with a good question, right? They like, there's a plane crash, some people died, we don't know who, think about it all summer and we'll see you in the fall, right? Teachers need to do this, right? Teachers, you leave with a question, you don't answer everything. Everybody on board with that? Like, we need to do a better job of that. And I'm gonna demonstrate that. So those are called gravity blocks. We're moving on. All right, so. I want to talk a little bit about dimension. I feel evil when I do that. How do these Hollywood people live with themselves? So I want to talk about dimension. So when we scale something up, if we take a cube and like double its size, what we're talking about is we're talking about doubling lengths. And that's not what happens to the surface area and the volume. And so if you can quickly calculate, you know, if you double the side length, if you go from 1 to 2 on the side length of a cube, you can quickly calculate that the surface area goes from, say, 6 square centimeters to 24. It goes up by a factor of 2 squared, or 4. And the volume of this cube goes up from 1 cubic centimeter to 8 cubic centimeters. It goes 2 times 2 times 2. So you get 8 cubic centimeters in the end, and that's 2 cubed. And the important thing here is that these exponents, the 2 squared, the exponent, and the 2 cubed, are, first of all, linguistically, that's why we call them squared and cubed. It has to do with the dimension, right? But those exponents are telling us the dimension of what it is that you're measuring. You're measuring surface area, which is two-dimensional, the exponent is 2. You're measuring volume, which is three-dimensional, the exponent is 3. If you double a one-dimensional object, all one-dimensional traits of it get 2 times bigger. All two-dimensional traits get 4 times bigger. All three-dimensional traits get 2 to the third times bigger, right? And so it's the exponent on the scaling factor that tells you the dimension. And that, in some sense, is what dimension is, right? That's what dimension is. And so I want to look at a particular object. There's actually examples of it upstairs here. I want us to take a triangle and split this triangle into 4 triangles that are all the same size and remove the middle one. Everybody got that? And how many triangles do we have now?
4.
We've removed the middle one. It's gone. Oh, we got 3, right? And now each one of those smaller triangles, I want you to do the same thing. Split it into 4 triangles, remove the middle one. How many triangles do we have now? 9, very good. We're celebrating being wrong. 9, okay. So now we take each one of those 9 triangles, we split it up, we remove the middle one, and we keep doing this, and we keep doing this, and we keep doing this. And we ask the question, if we do this forever, what's left? And in particular, the question I want to ask is, what's the dimension of what's left? And let me just give you two arguments here. One argument is that we started with a triangle which is clearly two-dimensional, and at every stage what we have is a bunch of triangles that are all small but still two-dimensional, and so this has to be two-dimensional. Here's another argument. We keep taking out the middle. Two-dimensional objects have to have some sort of middle, and we keep taking the middle out, and so maybe, but we never touch the edge. And so maybe, like, that edge is just one-dimensional. So maybe what's left is one-dimensional. And so what I want you to do is I want you to write on your piece of paper, this is question five, what's the dimension of this, which is called the Sierpinski triangle? What is the dimension of the Sierpinski triangle? Go ahead and write down what you think the dimension is. Write it down on your paper, and then compare notes with the people around you. Go ahead and write it down, and then talk to them. All right, here we go. We're going to figure out what the answer is together. Here's the thing. If you take a square and you double its size, you can actually see that you have four squares as big as the original in there, right? But when you take this object and you double its size, right, now we just have three of them, which seems really weird, right? If you take the square, what you get, it's a two-dimensional object, and so you get 2 squared times the area of the original. But with this thing, we get 3 of the original. We're not expecting the 3. We're expecting the scaling factor, 2, to some power, and that power was going to give us the dimension. But now we just get a 3. So in some sense, we were supposed to get 2 to the dimension. And so what has to happen is that 2 to the dimension has to equal 3. And you need some algebra to do that. You need logarithms. You figure out your logarithms, and the answer is that the dimension of the Sierpinski triangle is the log base 2 of 3, about 1.585. Let's hear it if you were wrong. Come on, let's hear it. All right. Right. You get a fractional dimension. Once you understand how to measure dimensions, the inescapable conclusion is that dimensions can be fractional. You can have dimensions in between 1 and 2, in between 2 and 3. You can have wonderfully fractal things which have dimensions, anything you want in there. And that's just an absolutely amazing fact. All right, one more demo here. So I've got this spool. The spool always reminds me of the age-old toilet paper question. Like, do you have the toilet paper hanging off the front or the back, right? And so we're going to do something similar. This table is a little slippery, so I'm just going to put this down to add a little bit of friction. And so the question is, here's an easy question. If I have the spool like this with the thread coming off the top, and I put this spool down and I pull, it rolls in the direction that I'm pulling. Everybody okay with that? That's exactly what you would expect. And so the question I have for you is, what happens if I flip it over? If I flip it over so that the string is coming off the bottom, right? And then I'm going to put it down here on this table. And then I'm going to gently pull in the direction I'm going to pull to your right. And the question is, do you think it rolls toward the puller? Do you think it rolls away from the puller? Right. And I'm just to be clear, I'm going to pull gently. I'm not going to jerk this thing. Right? Everybody understand the question? All right. Write down your answer. Take a stand. Write down an answer. And then turn to your neighbors and decide and convince them you're right. Go. All right. Here we go. Here we go. I'm gonna pull this gently, and we're gonna see which way it goes. Here we go. Gently pulling. Oh, I'm a little off center. I'm sorry. Gently pulling, and it definitely rolls toward the puller. Let's hear it. You were wrong. All right. I'm gonna give you two explanations for this. One of these two explanations is clearly wrong. So here's two explanations for you. Here's one explanation is that if I'm pulling, the only force is toward the puller. If the only force is toward the puller, then the motion has to be toward the puller. That's one explanation. Here's another explanation. What's really going on has something to do with the only point with friction in here at all is actually the point where the spool touches the table. And since I'm pulling above that, I'm going to get it to rotate in that direction around that point, which seems weird, because you're thinking about it rotating around the center. But if you rotate it around that, then it's also going to go toward you. Those are two arguments, one of which has to be junk. But I can demonstrate why one of them is junk. You see, if I pull high enough, I can get it to go the other way. I'm still sort of pulling in this direction, but I'm pulling at a higher angle. For those of you in the back, if I pull at this angle, it rolls away. But if I pull at this angle, it rolls toward you. And in fact, there's this cool demonstration you can do. If you have a dog, you might do this. I can take my spool for a walk. If I get the angle exactly right, I can take it for a walk, and it doesn't roll at all. It just walks along like that without rolling at all. And that's a really fun. So so let's hear, you were wrong, you were wrong? Yeah. All right, the strangest paradox in all of mathematics is called the Banach-Tarski paradox. And I have to tell you exactly what this says. The Banach-Tarski paradox says you can do the following. With either a solid ball or just the shell of a ball, either one, you can split it up into just a small number of pieces, like 6 pieces. You can take those pieces, you can take a few of them, like 3 of them over here, reassemble them into a ball the same size as the original, and then take the remaining pieces and twist them into another ball the same size as the original. Let me say that again. One ball, split it into pieces, take some of the pieces over here, get a second ball, other pieces over here, and get another ball, right? So you start with one ball. Without adding or subtracting any material, you end up with 2. It doesn't matter. The two balls at the end are the same size as the original. The same size and shape. They're both spheres. And you can do this, right? And in fact, if you felt like it, you could do it again and again and again and again. Starting with from 1, you could get as many as you wanted. I have to caution you. What I've said is true. If you're thinking that you should go down and buy a piece of gold, apply Banach-Tarski to it and get 2 pieces of gold, and this is going to make you rich, you're sadly mistaken. The pieces that we're talking about are really complicated. I mean, they're sort of like if I said, here's one piece of numbers between 0 and 1. One piece is the fractions that are sort of speckled. We can call that one piece. That'd be an example of the kind of piece that we're talking about. What you saw in this animation is just sort of an artist's interpretation of this. You can't actually, but the amazing thing, you can't see it, you can't do it in physical reality. The amazing thing is you can think it. Not only can you think it, but you can prove that it is true. And mathematicians have done this, right? And the end result of this is that not every set is measurable. There's a branch of mathematics called measure theory where we deal with the consequences of this. You can't measure everything, and so some things you just have to agree. You have to sort of give up the fact that they're measurable. Anybody wonder what this picture is that you've been looking at all night? It's not my backyard. It's a neighbor's backyard. This is. But this is true. I want you to fill in the blanks for me here. Every autumn, the leaves turn colors, and then they. Yeah, you're all wrong about that. Here, so I have the pictures to prove it. So this is a neighbor's tree, and one of the branches on this tree came down in a thunderstorm in July. And so there's the thunder. The thunderstorm took down that branch. That branch, it was cracked off, but it was still hanging there. And if you notice, all the leaves on that branch are brown, like they've dried up already. And if you go through the summer, so here we are a little later in the summer. The rest of the tree is doing fine, still brown leaves on that. Here we are into the fall. Right, and so a lot of the leaves on this tree have fallen down. Notice that on that branch, they're still hanging on, and they're still brown. You get into winter, there is not a leaf on that tree except on this dead branch. And now I claim this proves that we're wrong about this, right? And so I asked, leaves don't fall, they're pushed. This is what's really going on. You know, we're actually wrong about the turning colors thing, too. Like when we see maple leaves that we think are turning red, that red was already in there. It was just completely overwhelmed with green chlorophyll. We couldn't see the red for the green that was in there, right? And what's happening in the autumn is that the tree is sucking out everything it can get out of these leaves. And when it's done sucking nutrients and everything else it can and chlorophyll out of these leaves, it actually builds a layer of cells that are designed to cut off the leaf. It's like, thanks for all the nutrients, see ya. And off goes the leaf. And in this branch that's hanging there, it was cut off from the tree, and so the tree didn't have the ability to extract all those nutrients and then cut off the leaves, right? And all of those leaves, they didn't just fall, they're pushed. That's what happens in the autumn, leaves get pushed. I think all of you were wrong about that. Let's hear it, let's hear it, let's hear it. Here's the challenge I have for you, and this is the challenge I give to my students. I teach a class in mind-bending math paradoxes at St. Mary's College of Maryland. And what I really pitch these paradoxes is a little playground where we can practice changing our minds. when we think about changing our minds, we think changing other people's minds. We put ourselves in the position of Bob Eberling. The real challenge is, what if you're in the position of Bob Eberling's bosses? And you are wrong. You are dead wrong about something. What are you going to do? Are you going to have the ability to admit that you're wrong and change your mind? Or are you going to stick to your guns? Humans are incredibly good at ignoring evidence that comes in because it doesn't conform to what they already believe. Humans are incredibly good at dismissing the messenger. Like, oh, he's telling me that he's wrong, but he doesn't know what he's talking about. She doesn't know what she's talking about. We are really good at sticking to what we already believe. When it comes time and it's your moment, will you change your mind? And so I'll leave you with a challenge. It's the hardest assignment I ever give. It's my student semester project. You know, on some level, that you're wrong about lots of things. Find something important to you that you're wrong about, admit it, and change your mind. Thank you very much.
All right, we have time for a couple of questions, so if you could raise your hand, I will bring you the microphone.
Sorry about the little mess over here.
Yeah, I just wanted your thoughts on a thought I had, but when you were talking about the rational numbers and the probability of picking an, right, the graphic that came to my mind was stars in the universe, like the empty space, and maybe the, you know, numbers being stars and the chance of getting star. Any do you see any parallels or?
Yeah, so I like the fact that you're searching there for parallels and something that you know, the idea of our universe and how mind-bogglingly large it is and how many stars are out there. It definitely gets across the idea of huge numbers versus much smaller numbers, right? You know, the fact that, you know, our sun is one of, you know, I don't know, billions of stars within our solar, within our galaxy. Thank you for catching me there. Within our galaxy, and then that's just one of billions of galaxies, right? And so the numbers here are immense. That doesn't go far enough to get zero. That only goes far enough to get really, really, really small. But mathematically speaking, the chances of picking a rational are actually zero. Which, in order to get to actually zero, you need to be able to think about infinity, which is what so much of mathematics grappled with, right? And mathematics only figured out the idea of infinity in the 1800s, 1870s, 1880s. And when mathematicians figured out how to understand infinity, a lot of mathematicians didn't believe it. They're like, no, that can't be right. Right? And so mathematicians had a hard time changing our collective minds about that. But you really have to grapple with infinity in order to get that. But it's sort of along those lines. Yeah, question over here.
So, hi, thanks for a great talk. So to build on what you were just saying about mathematicians sometimes being changing their minds a little, like mathematics is a very certain subject where you like you're very definite about being right, 100% right. Can you give us some examples when mathematicians were really wrong and changed their mind?
Examples where mathematicians were really wrong. Well, so that's one of them. I think that the example is Cantor put out his ideas about infinity. And he was ridiculed by a lot of mathematicians for being completely wrong about that. And it was only a small group of mathematicians who started to build confidence in that and that being right. Other examples where mathematics got it really wrong, does somebody have one off the top of their head? Yeah?
Euclid's parallel postulate.
Ah, great. So Euclid had five axioms that all of geometry was built on. And for a really long time, people tried to prove the fifth one from the first four. Right? And most mathematicians thought you could. Right? Thought you could prove the fifth one from the first four. And there were lots of times when people thought they had proved the fifth one from the first four. And then it turns out you cannot. And in fact, you can develop lots of systems where the fifth one is wrong. And that's how you get spherical geometry or hyperbolic geometry and things like that. So there are lots of cases where mathematicians get it wrong. Here's another case where mathematicians, our intuition is wrong. There's something called the axiom of choice, right? So it's a fairly complicated thing. But the axiom of choice is one of the axioms that we all agree upon. Most mathematicians agree to sort of to accept it, you know, sort of on the same level line as like there is a zero. So axioms that we'll all start out with. And we all, the mathematicians know that there are all these other theorems out there that are equivalent to the axiom of choice, right? And mathematicians, we know this. We have this list in our heads, right? So, you know, so let's see. The well-ordering principle is equivalent to the axiom of choice. Zorn's lemma is equivalent to the axiom of choice. All these other things are equivalent in the sense that if one of them is true, all of them are true. If one of them is false, all of them are true, are false. But this is what most mathematicians think. Most mathematicians think the axiom of choice, yeah, that's true. Most mathematicians think the well-ordering principle, no way, that's false. And most mathematicians think Zorn's lemma, I can never remember what that one says. But at the same, like, we can hold these thoughts in our heads. Like, intuitively, it seems like the axiom of choice is true and the well-ordering principle is false. We can, mathematicians can hold that in our heads at the same time holding in the fact that we know that they've been proven to be equivalent. And so we are clearly wrong about this in some sense. Does that make sense? Great. Do we have any other questions? Yeah, over here.
So I don't know if this is allowed, but are you able to explain the gravity blocks to us?
If I explain the gravity blocks, then I'm like being every teacher, and I told you, like, there's a problem with that. And so this is what I'll say. I'm going to be here for a bit, and so, like, when we're done with the Q&A, come on up, and, you know, you can try your hand at playing taps. You can pick up the gravity blocks and see what you think. I'm not going to give anything away tonight, but, you know, email me what you think in a few days and see how that goes. And here's the thing. You're going to keep thinking about it. And it's going to eat at you. And that's the point. Like, that's my whole point. Like, keep thinking about that. We have another question over here?
Yeah, one more question.
Great.
Could you elucidate what you were trying to state about the difference between fractions and ratios?
Oh, fractions and ratios. Yeah. So fractions, when you add fractions, you have to find common denominators, right? When you're adding a fourth and a third, you have to find a common denominator, right? So you change those into common denominators. And once you've done that, you know, a fourth and a third, right, is 3/12 and 4/12. And then when you add them, you only add the numerators, and you get 7/12. If you're thinking about those as ratios, if somebody shot 4 out of 12 in the first half and 3 out of 12 in the second half, what did they shoot for the whole game? They did not shoot 7 out of 12. You don't keep the denominator the same. For the whole game, you add both the numerators, the shots they made, and the shots they took, and you get 7 out of 24, right? And so when you're talking about ratios, the rules are different. And the rules we have for fractions don't apply. One of the rules we have for fractions is that, you know, if this fraction is bigger than this fraction, and this fraction is bigger than this fraction, then when we add across, the result will be bigger. And that is totally true for fractions and not always true for ratios. That's the point. Does that make sense? Excellent. Thank you all very much. Thanks for a great evening.